Today we're gonna make a very detailed overview and a teardown on a Cisco Catalyst 3750G series 24-port gigabit layer 3 switch.
Welcome to Donkey Learning IT, where we go over certifications, hardware, software, and IT-related jobs Donkey style.
This is part of an educational series what I'm doing for certifications. The video is divided in three portions. In the first part of the video, we're gonna look at the outside of the device and we're gonna get some general feeling of how does it work. Then, in the second portion of the video, we're gonna look from the perspective of a CCNA candidate of what are the parts doing and how does the device roughly work. And in the last portion of the video, I'm gonna really do a 10 times magnification of the individual components and we're gonna look through the eyes of a repair technician to give you even a more deep understanding of what is going inside this hardware. These Catalyst 3750 series switches are highly successful by Cisco and they run pretty much rock solid. This is why you will find these switches in most organizations in their distribution layer or small companies when they are using a so-called collapse core, then you often find these switches in their core. And this is why I think it's important to look at these switches, because there is a high chance that you're gonna see them in a real production environment. Before we go into further details, one needs to point out that the 3750 and the 3750G, so the gigabit model what we are looking here today, they are both layer 2 and layer 3 switches, but their functionality depends on the iOS which is installed on the hardware itself. Normally these switches come with the so-called IP base license, which means that they are doing only layer 2 switching. If you buy the IP services license from Cisco, then you will be able to do also layer 3 switching on this hardware, which is really a step forward compared to a router on a stick. The main advantage of a layer 3 switch is that a layer 3 switch is able to do layer 3 switching, so routing at the end of the day, wire speed between different ports. On the left-hand side of the device, there are these LEDs which are displaying the current operational mode of the switch itself. There is a button here which you can push. You are then going over on the display to display different modes of operation, and also the LEDs will then either display like bandwidth or they will display the utilization, and there are several options but I don't really want to go into in this video. There is one thing what you be cautious about, is that if you press down the button for a long time, it's about 20 to 30 seconds, then you are erasing the configuration which is inside the switch. So that is really something what you need to be aware of. Next to these LEDs, then we have the gigabit ports at the front. So there are 12 plus 12, 24 in total. So these are standard RJ45 ports, where you can plug in the standard RJ45 network cable. And then here on the very right side, we're gonna have four of these so-called small form factor pluggable ports. These are not 10G ports on the 3750G model. They are still 1 gigabit ports. If you buy the newer 3750E and 50X, then those will have the option to have 10G ports. These SFP ports then use these small form factor pluggable jacks, which are then most of the time a type of media converter. So here on the other side, you can have different kind of optical outputs, either in multi-mode or single mode, or in this particular case, there is just a standard RJ45 output as well. So if I plug this jack in, or this SFP module here, then practically now I have one more port what I can use via RJ45 cable. This means that practically this 3750G is not just 24, but more or less a 28 port switch. In a real production environment, most of the time these four ports are used as trunk ports, where one switch is actually linked to another switch. On the back side of the unit, we're gonna find on the very right side this DC in jack, where you can plug in external batteries to this, or you can also buy some external power supplies. Then here we have the AC in. This is what most people use. Then here you're gonna find a console port where you plug in your Cisco rollover cable. These two ports here are a little bit special. These are the so-called stackwise ports. And what they are doing is that by connecting cables here, you can interconnect multiple switches with one each other. So then they can literally communicate like it would be a chassis, or like there would be a backplane connecting the different switches. To link two or more switches together through these stacking ports, you would use these so-called stacking cables or stackwise cables, which are of course made by Cisco for Cisco. And at the end of the day, these cables are doing a communication between the backplanes of the switches, and the protocol is very similar to the SCSI low voltage differential single ended type communication. I don't want to go into deep detail on the stacking in this video because I think that deserves a completely separate video as a topic, because it's a little bit involved and first one needs to understand the hardware itself. This stacking is a 1D torus topology. By having now two of these switches, what one normally does is that by using these stackwise cables, then you would put one of them in stack 1 and the other end of the cable in stack 2. Then you would cross the other cable also. This way you make now this ring topology, and the switches can communicate between the backplanes from one to another. Let us now get down to business and do a teardown of the motherboard and look roughly from the perspective of a CCNA where are the most important components on the board. I want to fit the full board into the picture as much as possible. If you wanna see more close-ups and magnified pictures or video discussing the components, that will be done in the third portion of the video. So here at the front, these are then the RJ45 ports and these are the SFP ports. So this is where the signal then comes in. And these below these black heat sinks, there are six of them on the board. So these are so-called quad PHYs or quad PHYs. Namely, they are doing the physical I/O, which means that they are operating on layer 1 of the OSI model. And since there are 24 ports at the front and there are 6 chips on the board, this means that every chip is taking care of 4 ports. So when you are on the console and you are making a command like interface ranged, I don't know, from gigabit 0 to gigabit 2 shutdown, then you are literally interacting with these PHYs or PHYs, the physical chips themselves, and you are shutting down the physical chip itself. Below these larger heatsinks, there are, of course, the Cisco ASICs or application-specific integrated circuits, and I will pop the lid off of one of them, and I will show you that these belong to the so-called Sasquatch series, and it's really a fun thing about Cisco that most of their components are, you know, named after like Sasquatches, and we will see like Yetis, and who knows, there might be unicorns and UFOs. I haven't seen the newer trend. These Cisco Sasquatch ASICs are operating then in the layer 2 and layer 3 of the OSI model. So it means that they are taking care of layer 2 switching and also of layer 3 routing as well, which of course requires some highly advanced chips because you need to do that in wire speed. So this is why these chips are generating quite a little bit more heat. These chips here, they are the so-called ternary content addressable memory, or TCAM. And what do they mean by ternary? Well, let us think about in a layer 2 switch, we are always just using MAC addresses, and based on the incoming packet, we just make a table, a CAM table, where we know which device is sitting on which port. Since we are not needing to do any type of routing, it means that we are just fine with a standard CAM table or content addressable memory, which contains either zeros or ones, because the MAC addresses are well defined. However, when we wanna do now routing or layer 3 switching, then we need this so-called ternary content addressable memory, because besides the zeros and the ones, we have to allow for a third type of digital signal, which is normally called X, which is non-defined, because you need to search through these routing tables, and for these search algorithms, you need to be able to have these so-called non-defined bit set. And this is why they are using this TCAM. Next to these very reflective, shiny chips, which are the TCAMs, then we also have now these black chips. And I think some of you have seen some very similar chips when you look at a Pentium 2 or an AMD slot A processor, which were in a slot. And these chips were normally next to the CPU, and they served the purpose as a cache. And also, this is the same thing what they are doing here. So these are a special type of random access memory, and you can access now the content of these memories really, really fast. And why do they need this memory? Well, keep in mind that these switches are so-called store and forward switches, which means that if there is a packet coming in, then it goes through, of course, the layer 1, then it goes to layer 2, then the layer 2 frame check sequence is being calculated. If the packet is bad, then the packet is discarded. However, if the packet is good, then we're gonna really keep the packet inside this buffer memory, so to say, or cache memory. And then we're gonna make some decisions based on your running config, And based on that decision, then of course we're gonna push the frame out. So we will do the same encapsulation now backwards. And then we come out to one of the ports at layer one. And then that's how we will communicate to another device. Now, if you count the number of these large heat sinks and all these chips, you will find that there are 7 of them. From each one of them, these are practically now clustered together. So we have an ASIC, we have one of these ternary content addressable memory and database search chips, and of course we have one of the buffer chips. And one of these units is then taking care of 4 ports. And now you might ask, why do we have then the 7th one? There are here now 4 of these SFP ports at the front. And for these SFP ports, of course, we're going to need, again, an ASIC, a TCAM, and the buffer chip. These 2 chips right here then are taking care of communicating between the ASIC and the 4 SFP ports. Next to these ASICs, which are the real muscle inside the device, of course, we also need some brain. Yeah, I said brains, like, you know, the zombies. Anyway, so here we have a route processor, and this Cisco Yeti route processor is then the one which takes care of running the iOS software. And the iOS software runs in this random access memory right here. And the iOS is loaded from this flash chip right here. I need to emphasize that this processor is not taking care of the layer 3 routing. That would be really, really slow. No, it's done here in hardware. When the processor is doing something, or only those cases when there is like packet fragmentation or you switch on some of the debugging, and yeah, there are specific cases when the ASIC is not flexible enough to do its thing, only that is the time when the route processor is doing actual routing in the layer 3 switch. Next to this route processor, we're gonna find 4 of these random access memory modules. So this is what you normally see when you do a show version. So these modules are the ones which are containing your running config. And also these are the ones where the iOS is being decompressed. And this is the flash chip. So this is where your iOS resides in an ELF 32-bit binary format. I have to mention that the flash chip, in addition to containing the iOS, it also contains the startup config, which is, of course, the configuration file, which is used when you start up the switch. So it takes all your configurations which you have punched in through the serial console or through some SSH. Next to the iOS and also the startup configuration, there is also a third file, the so-called vlan.dat file. And inside this vlan.dat, you have all the settings for the VLANs, and it can really lead to some issues if you don't delete the vlan.dat file when you move one of these switches to another environment, because really undesired things can happen. Because of this potential issue with the existing vlan.dat file is why Cisco nowadays encourages you to always put your switches into the VTP transparent mode. Next to the CPU or the route processor, here there is a chip which is taking care of converting the low-level signals of the CPU to the levels of necessary to drive the serial port here, to which you plug in your rollover cable. Right next to the console port, there are 4 of these chips, which are then doing the communication through the so-called stackwise cable, which I've showed you in the first portion of the video. So what happens is that here there is this data plane where most of the data is being sent between the ASICs, and then these chips are tapping into this data plane, and they convert this parallel data plane into a serial type communication. Then these chips are communicating with their counterpart from the other switch to which they are linked. Of course, in a large portion of the time, we have to send now some information from one ASIC to the other ASIC, and this is done over this parallel data bus here, what is called the data plane. So here one can see that the data comes out from one of the ASICs as an example, and then it runs through this data bus to the other ASIC, and of course this will then repeat over and over again, so that we have now this data plane running over the full motherboard. So now one can understand better that these stackwise ports here, via these four chips, are then nothing else but the prolongation or the expansion of this data bus here between the ASICs. On the bottom side of the board, one can particularly well see then this data plane then going from one ASIC then to the other, and then to the other, and so forth. We play the same game over and over again until this final ASIC is then coming to these four chips which I've just showed you on the other side. And this is how they are then expanding this data bus over the stackwise cables. In some portion of this data bus, which is a parallel bus as I mentioned, you're gonna see that some of these traces are wiggling quite a lot back and forth. And if you are wondering why is it so, well, the explanation is really simple. Namely, when the engineers have designed this motherboard, they were listening to the newest hit of Snoop Dogg with the title Wiggle Wiggle. You have figured out that's not really the truth, of course. So what is happening is that whenever you have a parallel bus, you always need to take care that all the signals arrive at the same time simultaneously. Because if one of the signals arrives out of touch, you know, at a different time period, then you completely misinterpret the data, because you think that, well, that bit didn't arrive, so that was a zero. And then after a couple of nanoseconds, it comes in and it says, oh no, I was supposed to be a one. And then, of course, the chip says, nah, sorry, too late. So this is why the traces has to be somehow having the same length. And in order to ensure that the lengths are very much similar, this is why often they do this wiggling, so that if you have very long straight paths, then now this trace here have the same length like the one, for example, who is taking now this corner here. When it comes to the hardware, I must admit that I could not find the chip responsible for containing the ROMMON. Nevertheless, I was not able to find this chip. So I don't know whether this is built already into the CPU. I'm not sure about it. If you have more information, please comment and put your idea below, and I'm more than interested to hear what you think about where is the firmware practically. Let us then have a look or go through in our mind how does now the boot procedure look for this switch here. What one could expect is that when you start up the switch, then the CPU gonna first take the firmware from the ROMMON and since I couldn't find the Roman chip, I cannot point to it. So yeah, it's taking the iOS or mini iOS in from this Roman. And once it have passed the power on self test, then it will look for, is there a boot system command or is there an iOS in this flashcard? If there is an iOS or there is a boot system command defining what to boot, then it will now bootleg this iOS from this flashcard here, and it will decompress it into this random access memory right here. So when you do a show version, this is the memory what you see in the output. And I must say that this is not really the memory to which your packets or frames are stored, because the access to these RAM chips is rather slow. Instead, these buffer RAM chips are those which are holding your packets. Anyway, coming back to the boot procedure. So once the iOS is decompressed, then iOS will look, is there a startup config file inside this flash? If there is a startup config file, then it will load it and it will set up the functionality of the switch according to this startup config file. Next, the CPU will communicate with all the ASICs, and considering that these switches support different type of SDM, which is not this old SDM what you think. No, this is the switch database management. So practically, if you don't know what I'm talking about, as a long story short, you can have multiple types of settings. Main thing is that there are multiple templates which you can put on the switch based on the same iOS. And in order to do that, the CPU then will set up the ASICs such that it optimizes or it really, you know, it changes the hardware such that it is optimal for this particular purpose. Then next, the switch gonna look at these ports here, these stackwise ports, and if there is no other device connected to these stackwise ports, then it will say, okay, I'm a master of this stack because there is no one else connected to me, so I will really do all my things and take care of business. If there is another switch which is selected as a master, then things are a bit more complicated. I don't want to go into such detail now. So after the iOS is fully booted, then considering that this is a layer 3 switch now, as an example, then due to the Cisco Express forwarding, it will actively look for to resolve the MAC address of all the next hops. Getting this MAC address from the very beginning is somewhat important, because it means that now we can really do routing at a wire speed, because we have most of the information. So when there is a packet coming in into one of the ports, then there is no need to send an ARP or address resolution protocol call for another device to, okay, please give me now your MAC address because I need that MAC address. The MAC address of the next hop is already in the CAM table, so all the things can be done on the fly. After we talked about the boot procedure, now let us play a game in our head. Let us suppose that there is a packet or frame, up to you how you prefer, coming into one of these ports here, and the switch have no information whatsoever, no entry of what device is on this port. And then this packet here is supposed to send out to one of these ports here somewhere. Okay? What will happen is that your packet is coming in here it's layer one. So at this stage, there is just, we are just talking about bits and bytes, okay? So these bits and bytes are then pumped into these files. So these files are just translating the signal level between the cable and between the ASIC. And then they are definitely working only at layer one. Then we are going to these ASICs, and then we start the encapsulation. So first of all, we're gonna look at the frame check sequence. If the frame is good, then we're gonna get the layer 2 MAC address, we're gonna put it into the ternary content addressable memory right here. And this is important to note that the MAC addresses are always learned based on the incoming packets. And once this TCAM table knows what device came in with which MAC address, that is memorized until you reboot this switch or you unplug it. So after we have done this decapsulation and we got the MAC address in the TCAM table, we go again higher. Now we are at layer 3 of the OSI model. We are still doing this via the ASIC. And now we're gonna look what is the source and destination IP address of this packet. And based on the routing table, we're gonna make decision of what to do with the packet inside. Then once the decision is made, then the packet is being re-encapsulated. Then if we have learned already what is the MAC address of the outgoing interface, then we're gonna take that from the TCAM table. We're gonna then encapsulate the packet, and now we have a layer 2 frame. And then this layer 2 frame will be sent through to this file, and then it's just translated to layer 1 back again when it is sent out through the wire to the other device. From the perspective of a CCNA, I think we have done a pretty good rundown of what is going on this board. And I've just looked at the timer and I realized that the raw material is nearly 40 minutes already. So I don't want to fit now the detailed overview when I'm zooming in on the particular components, because that would be like close to an hour video. Instead, I will present that part in a second part of this series. If you are interested, then I will put the link in the description below when I upload the video. And that is definitely meant for repair technicians. And probably it's also a better idea not to scare people away who are doing only certifications. I hope that this video has been informative, that you have learned something about how does this layer 3 switch works. And if you are interested in other educational and teardown videos, please just check out my channel, and you're gonna find several of these teardowns and overviews.